Hey you guys, it's Peter, and welcome to my channel, Peterisms, where I tell stories of my life and just little things that I have learned as I have grown into the person that I am today. And I'm just gonna get on here and do a real quick video today. My husband's gonna be home in just a little bit, so I wanted to get on here and just read some quick meditation and talk about it for a few minutes. So I don't know which book to read from today. Let's go with The Language of Letting Go by Melody Beattie. Can never go wrong with this book. Now watch, I say that and I'll open it. It'll be something that is so obscure and so hard to apply to this channel. Let's see what it says. December 2nd. Oh wow, I went right into the index. I didn't realize we were that close to the end of the year. December 2nd. Please be good. Putting our life on hold. Oh, this is interesting. Okay, this is kind of a longer meditation. It's like 2.5 pages. Okay. Putting our life on hold, December 2nd. We cannot afford to put our needs on hold, waiting for another person to fulfill us, make our life better, or come around and be who and what we want that person to be. That will create resentment, hostility, an unhealthy dependency, and a mess to deal with later on. If we have decided we want a particular relationship or want to wait about making a decision in a particular relationship, then we must go on with our life, with our own life in the interim. That can be hard. It can feel natural to put our life on hold. That is when we get caught up in the codependent beliefs. I have so done that before. That person can make me happy. I need that particular person to do a particular thing in order to be happy. That's a circumstance that can hook our low self-esteem, our self-doubt, and our tendency to neglect ourselves. We can get into this situation in a number of ways. We can do this waiting for a letter, waiting for a job, waiting for a person, waiting for an event. We do not have to put our life on hold. There will be repercussions from doing this. Go on with your life. Take life a day at a time. What is something I could be doing now to take care of myself, make myself feel better, get my needs met in an appropriate, healthy way? How can I own my power to take care of myself despite what the other person is or isn't doing? What will happen if I break the system and begin taking care of myself? Sometimes we get the answer we want immediately. Sometimes we wait for a while. Sometimes things don't work out exactly the way we hoped. But they always work out for good, and often better than we expected. And in the meantime, we have manifested love for ourselves by living our own life and taking the control away from others. That always comes back to us tenfold, because when we actually manifest love for ourselves, we give our higher power, other people, and the universe permission to send us the love we want and need. Stopping living our life to make a thing happen doesn't work. All it does is make us miserable because we have stopped living our life. Today, I will force myself, if necessary, to live my own life. I will act in my own best interest in a way that reflects self-love. If I have given power or control of my life to someone other than myself and someone besides a power greater than myself, I will take it back. I will begin acting in my own best interest, even if it feels awkward to do that. Wow. That was a really powerful meditation and a really good reminder for me, you know. I think when I look at the definition of codependency and how I understand codependency to work in my life, you know, one of the master traits of codependency is when you feel that your life is defined or dependent. Well, obviously, codependency is dependency on somebody else, but you define your life in relevance to somebody else or in relation to somebody else, right? So like, I am so-and-so's husband, or, you know, I am so-and-so's mother. Well, it's not just in that, though. It's in that feeling that you have inside. Right? And I think it's interesting when I look back on my life that I would say for the majority of my life, really until Alex and I got into marriage counseling. So you're talking, I don't know, my mid 40s, that I really believed that I needed to have a man to complete me. I really, really firmly believed that somewhere down inside. I don't know what that's from, you know, maybe divorced parents. I don't know, failed relationships of my own. I don't know what that's about. Attachment issues, need to be validated, acceptance. I don't know what that comes from, right? But what I do know is that I had this intense need to be validated and to need to be in a relationship. I needed to have somebody put a name on it, that I was their boyfriend. That used to be very, very important to me, that I was their boyfriend, or we were in a relationship, or, you know, we were a Facebook official or whatever. Like, that was very important to me, all of that crap back in the day, you know? And it's just so ludicrous and ridiculous in retrospect. And no offense to you if you feel that way, because it is ridiculous. You know, I read this article years ago that said those couples that post the most pictures together on social media are doing that to validate to themselves the realness of their own relationship, and that people that don't need to prove that as much are probably the ones whose relationships are doing just fine, you know? And I thought about that, and I thought that was really interesting, because we were doing okay at that time, and I can remember I was like, but we don't post 42 pictures a month, like, you know, Judy and Joe Smith or whatever, and Alex would be like, no, and we've never been that couple, and we're not gonna be that couple. But you know, one of the things that I realized when I got into marriage counseling, and this was paramount to me, okay, this was like so profound in helping me just see our relationship. And just bear with me when I have to talk this all the way through, or it probably won't make sense. It was that I realized, okay, in counseling, and so did Alex, through much work, right, that if we did not make it, okay, and we ended up getting divorced, that I was going to be just fine, that I was going to miss him, okay, and I would be very sad about that, and I would grieve the loss of my husband, and I would grieve the loss of this relationship, but I would eventually be okay. And that was such a hard thing for me to wrap my head around, like that I could consciously sit there with my partner and realize that if we didn't make it one day, I was gonna be okay. Because the Peter of before clung on to that, okay? Clung on to that idea that I need you, I have to have you. You, this Jerry Maguire crap, you complete me, okay? That I'm, who am I if you are not in my life? Who am I if I don't have you? I'm laughing because one of my old roommates, like, it's this old story, but she, her friend and her friend's boyfriend broke up, and at the door, she was like screaming, who am I if I don't have you in my life? And it's like, but that's so true. Like, so many of us have felt that way, but I really did feel that way. You know, who am I if I don't have this man in my life? And I'm talking more romantically now, but this could be with anything, right? You know, and I clung to that. I held on to that so hard. Like, I have to have this. And not just with Alex. I mean, every relationship I'd ever been in previously. And man, add addiction to that mix when I was actively using. And it made me, I mean, you want to talk about the word smothering. I mean, 100 times that, right? And nobody wants that in a relationship. And this is the thing that I realized through all of this, right? Was that if Alex and I didn't make it, I was gonna be just fine. And then what that made me realize was that I'm not in a relationship with my husband because I have to be, or because I'm dependent upon it, or because I don't know who I am if he's not in my life, or because I can't survive without him, but because I choose for him to be there, right? I choose for him to be there, and he chooses for me to be in his life. And that's powerful, right? Like, that is super, super powerful when we realize that the people that are in our lives, and that really for me started that whole kind of like idea, that belief system, that belief train, so to speak, of ideas system, that those people that we choose to allow to spend time of our life, me, if you're watching my video today, or, you know, your partner, or your boyfriend, girlfriend, or, you know, husband, wife, or work partner, or person that you run with, or work out with, or whoever, whatever, okay? Whoever we give our time to throughout the day, we are literally choosing to hand over parts of our life to that person. And that is a huge deal. That is a really huge deal. And when I realized that, and I realized that I pick and I choose, you know, to have my husband in my life, it made the relationship so much sweeter. It made me realize, wow, like, he's in my life because I choose for him to be there, and he chooses for me to be there. And I don't, like, have to feel this, strange need, like, I can't survive without that person, because that is not healthy. It's not healthy at all. It's, you know, it's a weird obsession. So anyway, let me know what you think about all of that. And it's not love. And it is not love. It is not love at all. It's not love. So anyway, let me know what you think about that in the comment section below. I love you guys, and I will see you tomorrow. Bye.